what were you doing yesterday?
Well, first thing, I would say, we have the recommended geometry, I know you for a math teacher, geometry, we use in the, that was here, no? The second point, I would say, is that even if we allow for this much richer structure, if we take the instant interaction, then we end up in GR, okay? So, how about GR? Is very much in this kind of loop. Because it's the one to obtain, that even if you allow for all the possibilities of hidden, in the connection, be there. And if you use the instant interaction, that is the simplest action you can think of. And then the third point I would say is that even for more general theories, the ones we were discussing yesterday, like the function of the metric and the symmetric part of the Ricci tensor, the connection still doesn't give you provided use of it. At most, it will give you a modified coupling of the metric tensor, of the matter fields to the metric tensor. So you will get GR, but now the source will not be the elemental tensor, but something more complicated. So I can say that uniform interactions the connection is an auxiliary. Okay, this way it's an auxiliary field, so can take it out, and then the effect, will be to modify the source of gravity. So again here, I mean, this is GR, and you modify the directions of the matter. So again, I'm saying GR stands out very special theory. But then, I don't want to give you one impression here, that if you take any theory, any Lagrangian, and you consider the quantitative formalism, then the connection will always be an auxiliary field, and then you will not have any provided the so this is something that I'm explaining today, I didn't discuss, but okay. So and I'm gonna give you a very simple example. We were discussing this biogeometry, okay? In biogeometry. The connection is defined by D plus symmetric, so vanishing motion. Okay? So then you can solve this equation for the connection, and schematically you will get something like the Lebesgue beta plus some terms here will be at this point. One vector and one measure tensor with the appropriate contractions. Okay? So then in this theory you can take the Ricci scalar. Let's try this. So the Ricci scalar of the full connection will give you something like in the end, the Ricci scalar of the Lebesgue beta plus a mass term for this. Something like m squared. Okay. Now, if you take, so then again, if you stick to this action, this is an auxiliary field, there are no kinetic terms for this. But now let's consider quadratic action in the river, so we can, for instance, this term, this is the analogous of the Ricci, quadratic Ricci term, but now I'm using only the homothetic tensor. But actually, you can use an arbitrary. You can take an arbitrary contraction, but I take it away. Okay, and this will give you among other things. It's not difficult to see. Okay, remember I told you this is anti-symmetric. Okay, the homothetic tensor. And for biogeometry, this homothetic tensor happens. happens to be proportional in the semantics for this factor 2, some factor here. F min u for the vector. For the right vector. Okay. So if you write down terms like this, you will generate a matrix term for the vector. And now this vector will be will propagate. Okay? So by using this matrix geometric structure, you can actually have more propagation than this.
Do you mean that that vector will propagate because you are saying from the very beginning that this vector field is a field? This kind of thing?
No, I'm saying that if you have this dimension, okay, this dimension of the space time, now you want to write the direction, you will start by writing something like that. And here, the reaching. Your connection of this plus, if you want, terms, parameters, and terms, or taking the ribbon of this connection. In particular, you can write this term. Okay. And then, this is your comment, this is what you usually do. Now you can expand everything in terms of the remaining quantities plus the extra piece that you have. So this will lead to Einstein figure. This will lead to the reaching plus the master. Okay. This will come from here. And then these terms will lead to this like this. Among other things.
Which is you could contract with high orders of the Riemann vector. You can have something like by referent.
When you say
R mu rho sigma, F mu rho sigma.
Yeah, so this.
They will appear within your
operation. So you can write down the most general quadratic action for that. That's what we did. And then you get Maxwell. You get the master, and then you get some interesting interactions because they belong to the generalized Fock interactions, which is a generalization of Pandesky as a vector field. So I think this is a very nice geometry for this series. But the point I want to make here is that even for the roots, if you do not get any propagating additional degree of freedom, when considering quadratic terms, you can make it propagate. Okay? And this is an example of a case where by adding a rich geometric structure you can have additional propagator uses, unlike in this case. Okay.
I mean, the point is that nothing prevents you from running higher order operators, right?
Okay, what is the theory?
Thank you. Sorry?
Ah, yeah. Okay.
All the topics, higher order.
So what you're saying is that even if I start with this, yeah, I will have to use additional. Quantum corrections, and those will give me a propagating term. Much better. Yes.
So will we be unstable, or those will be stable?
Yeah. Okay. So now, I wanted to explain the ADM formalism, but very quickly. Who is familiar with that? I don't want to say more powerful, but it allows you to write down more dynamics.
So I mean that the point 3 means that that's why some people think, yeah, that the connection is treated as an independent object from the metric, and the action involves any function of both metric and that independent connection.
Yes.
That will be that one of new dynamics.
Another function, and this metric part,
which is the connection, which is not
the connection is completely in the So I mean, this map content, DT, tangent, DT, tangent. This is linear, this is linear, DT, square root of M, M that we have computed. This this square root of G and G. This M, this is M. So this is 1 over square root. Okay? Why am I doing this? Because now you see that there is a difference between proper time and this is what you usually call the labs. Okay? And this will be one of the things of the other one. Well, now what you're doing is formalizing is to write down the decomposed metric into somehow time-like part and spatial part. So you use this last factor here, and then here. Let's go and make a so we should put it in here. How about it? That's why I have to keep all the degrees of freedom there. Right. So this is only to give you an intuitive for the components that we have in this ADM decomposition.
Right.
And why we're working at this.
Right.
Yeah. So at the end of the day, if you want to make a decision, for permission, you can take 5 by 2 and make a decision. But this is because now I want to show the structure of the signature.
Yeah.
Sorry, one more thing. What about the signature? You wrote dt squared with a positive sign and symmetric. So you have minus?
Well,
somewhere.
That's enough. Right? It depends on what the idea is.
You can say that that's minus.
That's the trajectory. So the percentage is minus. Okay, so now take the instant direction. And write everything for this decomposition. Okay, that's what we do. And then we find this is. You see that? So these things will only depend on the other things. All the dependencies on N and beta L are these ones. You see that they enter linearly. Okay? And this is crucial. This is completely different from what we had yesterday with the connection. The connection entered the axon with no derivatives, but it was not a linear dependence. And this meant that the connection was an auxiliary field. That when you integrate out, gives you an effect. Okay? This means that these fields are Lagrange with derivatives. Okay, when you vary with respect to this field, you will get the constraints C equals 0. This is a Hamiltonian constraint, the one that Juan was using also yesterday. And it will give you a momentum constraint. Okay? Now, if we want to count the visual field, in the metric we have how many? It's a symmetric tensor in four dimensions. Roughly. How many components? Independent components? That is the metric. Yes. Somewhere.
10.
Thanks. 10. 10 independent components.
Is it not official free? Components.
When I say division field, I mean independent components.
Yeah? D plus y over 2.
Yeah. Perfect. Yeah. Okay. 10. And now, this will give me a constraint. Okay? So that will remove one degree of freedom, one component. Okay? And one. This will give me three constraints. No? That will remove three. And we have. but there's nothing wrong here. No? We know that the variable has how many polarizations? 2. We get 6. What's wrong? Is it correct? What am I doing? Am I counting correctly?
You know, missing something, right?
I'm missing something. Something. It's very deep. I mean, it's a paranoid idea. Okay? And that you all know, by the way. That you are too shy to say. The other Lagrange multivariate. That means that this constraint will be first class constraint. Okay? That means that they will introduce redundancies in your theory. In particular, as I was saying, this is giving you the prerequisites in. Variance of time. And this will give you a spatial diffeomorphisms. Okay. So this is the structure that gives you diffeomorphism variance. Okay. When you have that, it means that yes, you have these three constraints, but then you have four redundancies. And so. And now this is two. And we have it. Here. now I want to start the fifth year approach to the act. And for this, Raul has a very nice paper about this. I would recommend you all to read it. And so, as you can imagine, for spin to fill, because we all know physically, I will try to write it well. Things are complicated because of the structure. So the aim will be to give you the main ideas with simpler examples. Okay? So, from then, since I am not this short of time, so I'm going to start with the spin one. Then what we'll do is there's something obvious here, right? How to get the constraint to remove one in the field. If you work on this, if we make this equal zero, we will have a constraint that I not is zero. And we can achieve this if A is not. Okay. Then you all easily realize that when I plug this here, what I get is a minimum. Then we can complete the Hamiltonian. lubrication trainer.
Yeah.
So all I'm saying is that they could have even something like this. Okay? And then you will jump at it. So you need to grab this and then to get my instructions. And this is this is where I find the duty. Who is this? Raul has it. See? I'm saying that this is where I find the beautiful. Yeah. Because then you see that if n squared is equal to 0, then this constraint is continuous. And that means that this constraint is a first class constraint. And that means that it generates a gate solution, a redundancy in your theory. Okay? And this redundancy is E1. And that's why your muscles feel instead of, so this constraint, instead of removing only one degree field, we remove two. And that's why your muscles perfectly will have two polarizations. Okay? But for a massive one, they do not commute. And that's why you have three. Okay? And it's all because of this. Because if m squared is zero, a not only enters the linear ring. Okay? So it's a much bigger, very much bigger. But if you have a mass term, it's an auxiliary field. And then it will only remove one degree field. Okay? Okay, so this is the theory for. Who has seen the problem of now coupling this guy to a conserved current? So you know that you have this field, this is a free field, so unless you couple the field to something, it's completely uninteresting. Right? The interest is in interactions. And then we know that the natural way of coupling this is to a conserved current. Okay? So that means for the sake of generality, for simplicity, let's consider a scalar field. Complex form, so we have a U1 symmetry, global symmetry, and that will give you a conserved current. Okay? And now you can couple this field to this conserved current. And now you know that you can iterate this process, and again, so who has seen this? Who knows this? Then I think it's interesting to see, because it's a very systematic way of constructing these interactions. So you see that we have a symmetry, if you want, phi, with some constant alpha. Yes, okay, so infinitesimally. So now we can take variations of this parameter, and then you will have you are familiar with computing the process of motion and mass. Okay? So there's no one part here because it's complex. So here we have minus box plus delta down. And then plus alpha or mu phi plus phi star mu delta. Yes, that's correct, right? Okay, so this gives you the equation of motion for phi star. This one for star is complex conjugate. Okay. This is the equation of phi, and this is the boundary term that will give you the current on shape. Concept on shape. Okay? So from here we obtain the current and what is corresponding to the factor I and a constant Q. And then where this delta phi star is just phi, and delta phi is phi star. So we have something like phi mu phi star minus phi phi star mu phi. Let me check if I have the sense correct. Are they correct? if I have this here, let's let's see here. Let's now focus on the massless term. Okay. That's the photo. If you complete the process of motion, you will get this equation. Okay. And what we want to achieve by introducing interaction is to make that current the source of this. Okay, so we want to have here this. Okay, to achieve this, what we do is we correct the parameter by adding this term. So now when I take variation with respect to a nu, the massless part will give me this. This is linear in a nu, so I will get the current as a source. Is it clear? Okay. And now there is a problem here. Namely, does anyone know what I want to say, except the font? The problem is that this is a case field now, okay? So you will have some Bianchi identities. So if I take the divergence of this equation, this is symmetric, this is anti-symmetric, so this is identically zero, okay? This is an identity. Here I will have this. Okay. And now you can say, but this is conserved. So this is zero. But this conserved on shell. But on shell of what? Of this. But we have introduced this. Okay? So now this will not be conserved anymore. So this will be different from zero. See that? So if I compute, if you want, if I take the divergence of this, I will get essentially t mu phi, mu phi, all these mixtures with cancel, and I will be left with phi box phi star minus phi star box phi. And then if box phi is zero, and box phi star is zero, this is conserved. But this is the question of motion of this Lagrangian. Not of this one. I mean, not when I have this. Okay? So this is the consistency problem. And that's why now we need to correct this.
Okay? Cool. What am I talking about? What am I talking about?
Yes. So now we need to correct this. So we need to ask here some direction. So what we need to do is to compute the current of the full action. Okay. And this is not that difficult, so I will get the same. So this is exactly the same. And I'm probably missing some factors of Q and I. I want to do it a bit less. And then plus I have to vary this. And this is minus a mu I q. And then I have to take the ratio. And this is delta phi in mu star plus phi in mu star minus delta phi star in mu phi minus phi in mu delta phi star. Okay, so this will give me the correction to the once I integrate the parts. Okay? I have this derivative, I have to integrate the part. This will give me the correction to the equation of motion, and then the total derivative will give me the correction to the conserved current. Am I going too fast?
I guess, but it's like the iterative process.
Yeah, so it's the same.
Good, like...
yeah, it's the same. So I'm taking the variation. Now I need to take the parts here. No, not here. Here. And here. While the derivative is acting on the variation. We need to deliver parts, and this will generate the value term that will be the correction to the. Okay? And well, in this case, can I got it? It's not very easy. Correction.
Additional?
coming from the constant in front of the directions, right?
I think this is fixed.
But you how?
Oh, well, I don't know. So I think it's fixed because what you have is, this will lead to the current. Okay? From the current you get the correction to the current. Mm-hmm. And the Q comes from here. So it's already here. And the other Q comes from the transformation property.
What is it? What I'm here is the quantization of the charge. Or if you know it's up to an arbitrary value alpha.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you could always change the value of
it. Yeah.
It doesn't say that the charge is contact, that's you need something else. You know, to for the moment, Q is just any value.
But I think what it means is that this here you don't need to have Q squared.
No, well, what I was trying to mean is that I'm not sure whether the construction is unique.
Ah, I'm not sure.
You say it's unique?
No, I don't think it's unique.
So this is can solve any problem in A, but then it would be reflected in Q.
Also, I'm going to check the
generics. Yeah. That's why from fifth theory, typically you run instead of minus b u squared or minus 1 quarter, you say minus 1 over 4 g squared.
Mm-hmm.
And squared. So you always have a freedom. So absorb any constant g into the A field. Then you have freedom. Mm-hmm. You have a Q.
Zero, one, two, and that's it. Because I was very smart. So let's stop here. Let's remove trackers, okay? The thing is that if I put two planets here, what would they do? They will attract each other, okay? So this will allow me to eliminate something. If I have two charges, yes, if you have two positive charges, they will be very short. Okay? So this, for this, I usually like to write the effective potential for all these fields, because I think there is something interesting, but some sign, I will not do it. I already did it after the lecture for those who are interested. If that sounds good. Good? And then there is something else, no? That maybe is not obvious, but we know that gravity interacts with light. If I have a photon, it will have enough light, the sun, for instance. Okay? This means that I can eliminate what? What? Because you know that the spin do, no? We have to do that. No, there is one. No, it's because, again, this is something that at the lowest possible order, the leading interaction of a scalar field to matter will be understood. No? This is interesting to come. And then you see that this starts to the trace of the animal tensor. And the animal tensor. Maxwell field is traceless. So that means that you will not observe the beginning of light in this theory. Okay? So then, I hope we are convinced that we should try to describe gravity as an interactive theory mediated by spin.
Sure, it's an interesting way of finding it. If you accept the equivalence principle and you cancel and record it in you're not accepting it.
No. So all I want to assume is Lorentz invariance. Not so. Explicit Lorentz invariance. As we did for that. See? I mean, actually there, I didn't consider conservation of charge. But, well, when you have an interaction. But of course you have it. Okay? Here, at the end of the day, even if you don't ask for it, you will have the equivalence principle. And this, in the Bible, there is a very nice explanation why this is so. It's because you can have a process, then you have some soft gravity, you know, and then page invariance, you need to assume this, but this is a requisite that what you will obtain from here. And this will tell you that there is a concept thing declared by a constant, a coupling constant. I think it's a momentum, if I remember correctly. And for this to be zero, the only possibility is that all particles couple with the same strength to the gravitational field. So you actually obtain the equivalence principle. Okay? You don't need to do so. I'm not going to show that, but I urge you to.
The argument for spin 2 is tidal force.
Yes?
For spin 2 is tidal.
And also with this Moshe method, you can also put the equivalence principle that must be satisfied when you consider things three plus one. Interactions. Is that or do you remember?
Do you try to move?
That's when you consider this. I don't remember if it's this one or this one. The gravitons?
Yeah.
So you can't you can write down the analytic properties of the amplitude of these processes in terms of the helicity of the interacting particles. And then you can then you have given analytic structure that you want. And for that you can compute the helicities and some properties. For the spin 2, you get that the current switch.
You briefly mentioned the problems you didn't want to mention about higher speeds. And secondly, please write down the reference you mentioned about soft gravitons as providing
references.
Thank you.
4.
Yeah, let me invite it for both massive and maskless. Okay? So this is for n squared equals 0. And so operator is. And now this is Union, is Eta Union, plus Union over H. Okay, do you see anything disturbing here?
The one.
So if we take the limit of n going to zero,
okay,
this should be left, all these projectors should go like eta, nine four dimensions, or this p will go to eta, but this factor, instead of being, this is what? One, this will be 4/2. Okay? So you see that the interaction of a purely exactly massless P2 and the interaction of a massive P2 in the limit of the mass going to zero do not match. Okay? And this is this very famous VVVZ discontinuity. Okay? And what is the reason for that? The reason for that is that for the massless spin 2 we have two precessions. For a massive spin 2 we have 5. Okay? It's like for a vector. Massless vector, 2. Massive, 3. In this case, going from the massless to the massive, we'll add 3. These are correct. Helicities. And then, when you have a limit of the mass going to 0, of course, the helicity 2 component will go to the usual gravity. Mm-hmm. The helicity 1 will decouple from this. But the helicity 0 will give you, will remain there and will give you an interaction of this type. Okay? So it means that even in the limit of the mass going to 0, you have this additional force. Okay? And the resolution to this, hopefully, we will see some. It's scheduled for Thursday, so probably on Friday. And it's because, of course, when you go to the mass going to zero limit, and you are close enough to the object producing this gravitational field, you will have a given scale called Einstein radius, below which some radius here, below which these interactions of this light become very important, and then inside, it's actually in the screen. We will see how this happens.
Those interactions are
screen.
Those interactions are screen.
Yes. Yeah, so this guy will come with some kinetic term. So I have one. And then here some certain interactions. They are certain interactions, okay? This is the STC model of the gravity. So you have some shift in the linear screen. So you have something, I think something like this, some cubic element. So at some point this step becomes more important than this one. And then phi, instead of having the usual Coulomb behavior, one over r, goes like a square root of pi. So instead of going like this, here, it goes like that. And then only the force we need to buy this in, but I will explain this in my and with this angle too. Spin 1 interactions with the conservation of charge. So there is nothing deep, there is just interaction of interaction, consistency of interactions. Lorentz symmetry and unitarity. That's all you need. And for when you do the same for the spin 2, you get that the analogous condition is the equivalent species. So essentially, you have some processes, and then you have some.
No. But the equivalent special that you're describing is a weak equivalent special. I'm talking about the strong.
No.
So gravity is the same way as mass.
Yeah.
That's the strong equivalent special. But what you're describing is that particles which behaved under that field would couple along the same strength. That's the weak equivalent special. You could perfectly satisfy the weak equivalent special, but not the strong equivalent special.
But I think, again, this is.
Okay, I'll check.
This is correct. Of course, this is at the lowest possible order in the universe. Okay? So the leading order interactions if you want. Then of course at higher orders, you could break the inconsistency of interaction, do not give you the correct fit, but you would have fine. But you would do higher interactions, you have a lot of stuff. So but that's the lowest possible order. But this is in my version, I don't remember the chapter, but I think it's the end or something like that. Soft processes or something like
that. So I don't really know too much about this at all. It's not really a very good question, but when you have a massive gravitational field, like now you have the gravitons coupling to cells, right? The gravitons. The gravitons now have a gravitational charge, but with the electromagnetic model up there, the mass and the electric charge are different. I'm trying to sort of get this out without sounding stupid, but would it maybe a better comparison be to have a charged electric field? And then
No, because the analogous is there, but again, if I'm going to give you the standard answer. There we want to couple a mu to a conserved charge, to conserve current.
Yep.
Now you want to put a charge. Okay. Here, again, you want to couple the spin to field to conserve the current. And then the most natural current that you can think of is the energy one to the tensor.
Yeah.
So,
I guess.
Are you talking about gravitons self interacting versus photons?
Ah, no,
self interacting.
Yeah.
So, now the comparison would be with Young New series, where there you have the same issue. You can play the same game, but instead of having only one vector field, so imagine you have a bunch of vector fields. And here some A, B, okay? Some vector fields. And here you have some matrix, let's call it Z. Okay? And the linear problem. Now here you have a bunch of vector fields, which is a U1 symmetry. But on top of that, you have a global symmetry. Because you have some eccentricities of this metric, and this will give you a global symmetry for this vector field. That will be conserved current. Now, the same happens. Since these are our charts, you can try to couple this field to its own conserved current. And when you do that, you don't stop at second order, you stop at fourth order, and in the end, you get the full Tannhäuser theory.
Sorry, so that can you get one?
At the end, when you do all the these iterations, you will stop at fourth order, and this global U1 will become the gate symmetry, the gate beyond mean symmetry, and this mu will become the mu.
Make an additional ingredient, which is the structure function. So what kind of gauge group have you got? For instance, how is the A the only commute with each other? That's going to give you F A C.
So what I'm saying is that you have this here, you have a global symmetry given by the symmetries of this region. In the end, what you will get is the Gates theory. You make this global symmetry local. Mm-hmm. And then you work the Yamil theory for this global symmetry, and this one you get.
What do we say? AA, the computer, actually gives you structure function.
But this is what I mean when I'm saying that you obtain directly from here. Uh-huh. So when you cover these fields to themselves, to the conserved current,
the only way
you
can
get to this. And the same with this function methods. If you look at the vector fields interacting, this, let's call it A, B, C, then analytic properties of this Catlin amplitude will impose that the only possible interactions are those in which they interact through a Jankowitz structure. Well, seeing this is beautiful, but you need more of a problem. So here I'm trying to keep everything simple. So for myself. It's clear about all this. Is it clear where I want to get? Tomorrow, no? The ideas are clear. So you can imagine how rarely we do something very similar. Things are much more complicated because you have no indices around.
So the fact that they are, that those coefficients do over D minus 2, is that obvious? So how do you get this combination of products of etas just from interaction? So your propagator has a structure that is very specific.
Because there is another course of
one very simple one.
So one is Weinberg, okay? So the way he constructs the part of the theory, these are parameters, only by the particle content and interactions. And then if you have a massless in two representation, then you end up with this parameter. If you want to write it in an explicit Lorentz covariant way. Another way of doing that is once you should obtain the action, the quadratic action for the graviton, you invert the quadratic part, you get the comparator.
True if you have a cosmological constant. Right. So are you excluding the possibility of a cosmological constant?
So you are saying that in the city you can have
because in the city you can have higher spin
have
mass
higher,
and higher spin interactions.
Yeah. I don't know this of this higher spin fields in this or in the city probably. Right? Because the city is more, it's trickier. The city is more, you have more to formulate quantum theory.
think you can still. I mean.
you're right. This is because the sitter is Minkowski in 5 dimensions. So if you increase the number of dimensions, you increase the number of. Yes.
Yeah. Well, if you want to copy your background to the degrees of freedom, and you're assuming that the background.
Yeah, so this is your instruction, I know.
It's a field.
It's a field, yeah. So, carry out the lab of modularity. I didn't say that. In the alien formalism, if you compute the Hamiltonian, you see that it's pure for strength. Is it there? So, Hamiltonian is pure for strength, so it vanishes. And this is one of the problems for quantum gravity, I guess. Because if you want to do this background independent methods. Otherwise, if you treat gravity this way, as we will see on Thursday, as an effective theory formulated in Minkowski, it's a perfectly valid quantum field theory, effective quantum field theory, up to landscape without it. But there's nothing wrong with quantum gravity as an effective theory up to that scale. So, in this sense, I would say that eta mu nu is my background in this phase. And that's it. So now you can interpret eta mu nu plus h mu nu as a given measure. But this is an interpretation. I could always say, no, I'm working flat space time, and h mu nu is some quantum field provided there.
Mm-hmm. Also, with some expected value to the
more questions,
comments, complaints? Well, you said it's a quite a problem. If you take the Hamiltonian constraint as a constraint on your Fock space, then
This is only if you
want to act on your operator.
This is only if you want to quantize the full thing.
Yeah, the full. Sure.
But no, for me, this is something God did. And this is my quantum field. That's another problem.
You can call that quantum field theory because
we can. Yes, we can.
It's not the same thing. It's not correct.
No, but then. You can do what you're doing in Kersley's time. What I'm saying is that. Because even there, you can say that you have Minkowski, and then you have some. Some change are back in the particles, so graviton and then the perturbation is the quantum field property on top of this one. It's like a heat sphere, right? So you have in the working phase, back expectation value, but if you're in the proper phase, you have some back expectation value, and then the quantum perturbation will propagate on top of it. And this will have effects. You have this and all that.
Yes.
So this, I need to take this.
In fact, the sitter is including the Higgs.
Getting this right.